Shaking of hands, unless you're in the same social bubble. Morning. Morning. And let's begin with our opening responses, which are printed on the sheet of paper for your convenience. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
The Lord of glory be with you.
The Lord bless you.
With friends and strangers, with family and neighbours, we gather. Come among us, healing God, with that love that never ends. With faith reaching out to touch, with hearts straining to trust, we hope. Come among us, friend of the broken, with your compassion which makes us whole. With word and wonder, with silence and song, we wait. Come among us, dryer of our tears, we lift us to follow you. Are we ready to worship? Our worship band will lead us in the songs that are printed on the order of service.
Morning, everyone. Lovely to see everybody. It really is. After all that time we spent behind the screen, and in front of the screen on Zoom. Our music group this morning, we've got Peter on drums. Some of you may recognise Peter from our back garden in the last 12 months. He doesn't live there. He's got his own house, but he's kindly joined us on drums. We should have Al with us this morning, who had Lester with the boat. Unfortunately, our son was a little poorly during the night, so it's Lester on vocals, then it's myself on guitar. We're going to start off with our only song, Come On and Celebrate. The words available on your service sheet, and although we can't sing, at least try and hum along a little bit. Thank you.
Christ alone, my hope is found.
favourite songs, is Always My Shepherd. It's a modern take on a wonderful old hymn. For your endless mercy follows me, your goodness lead me.
We thank you that you are the God in whom we can trust. In the ups and downs of life, you are there. In the struggles that we have, you're with us. In the challenges we face, you give us strength. Father, we thank you for your presence with us now by your Holy Spirit. Fill us anew with your life-giving Spirit. Surround us with your love. Encourage us in our own journeys, the challenges we face in this life. And we thank you, Father, for the grace that you give to all. Your grace, that totally unmerited favour of God. Simply because you love us. Praise your holy name. praise the God of Isaac and Abraham, of Moses and our God. We thank you, Father, that in every challenge we face in this life, we can trust that you will be there to bring us through. Because of the pouring out of your grace, your love, your spirit. Come among us. Amen. Right, we have some activities for our children to do this morning. I think you've already got them and it looks like you've started. So how about if I leave it to the end and then you can come and show us what you've been doing and share with us what you've learned. That's probably the right way around to doing it today. But we're going to begin with our Bible reading now. Emma's going to bring that to us.
Our reading this morning is taken from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 5, verses 21 to 43. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered round him, and he was by the lake. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, but she was no better and rather grew worse. She'd heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you? How can you say who touched me?" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they had said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. And when he entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha, come," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Well, hopefully some of you might have recognised that song. Anyone? No? No?
You do.
It was. Well done. Why did I choose that song?
Did you like it?
Because it's about grace. It's not. I mean, I do. I like you too, and I like that song. But, I mean, it's getting on a bit now. It's 21 years old, that song. So, are you familiar with it, Robbie?
Vaguely.
Vaguely, right. Right, brilliant. We'll have to talk about that. Well, apparently C.S. Lewis walked in on an academic discussion about the distinctiveness of Christianity. Those present were about to decide that there was nothing that set Christianity apart from any of the other world religions, because they were unable to come up with anything that truly marked the Christian faith and set it apart from the rest. So they put the question to Lewis. He paused for a moment and said, "That's easy. It's grace. Grace is what makes us who we are as followers of Jesus Christ. Grace is what motivates us to respond with love and joy and hope. Grace is what equips us for living in this world and what allows us to create a sense of community as we seek out other recipients of God's grace. It is what we have come to offer the world, nothing of our own, but the gifts that come from God, the gift of grace." Of course, there's a definition of grace, the totally unmerited favour of God. I'll just repeat that. The totally unmerited favour of God. And I would like to suggest that the gospel that we've had, the reading that Emma shared with us earlier, is an example of that totally unmerited favour of God. Jesus seizes the moment and responds to the need, and is fully present with those who come to him. And that's an example to us all of how to live a Christian life. Being fully present is what is needed. The trouble is we get distracted and caught up in busyness and the demands of the world around us. I've certainly felt like that this week. It's just been one of those weeks where I just don't seem to have had a chance to stop and think. Jesus also crossed boundaries. Yes, man-made boundaries, but boundaries nevertheless. He crosses into areas where he is not welcome. Now, Monday the 21st of June, a date which I'm sure is fixed in all our minds, but it didn't come to be. It was meant to be that day, wasn't it, when finally the barriers and restrictions we've all been living with for the past 15 months or so would be lifted. But the barriers are still in place. Boris has stated this week, though, that July the 19th is the new Freedom Day, just in time for the long summer holidays. Now, for most of us, that's great news, but for many, social barriers existed long before COVID, and will still be there once the restrictions ease. Homelessness, mental health conditions, old age and illness can all push people to the edges of society. Basically, those cast aside by society. For some people, it's just a struggle to fit into a world measured by appearance, affluence, and achievement. The barriers to education facing poorer students of all colours, but specifically white working class students, have been in the news this week. Then there are those barriers which keep us from doing the things which we feel called by God to do. Barriers put up by the church itself to prevent those not properly authorised or recognised from doing what they feel is part of their ministry. Then there are the myriad of things in this world which prevent us from fulfilling our calling. Things which eventually frustrate us and lead us away to the point of losing purpose. Interruptions and distractions. Jesus didn't get exasperated at interruptions. I do. And I suspect some of you may also get exasperated with all interruptions which come towards us. But you know what it's like, don't you? You're in the middle of something and someone comes asking you to get involved in something else. Might only seem a little thing to the person asking, but it takes you away from what you're focused on. It's a distraction. It's an interruption. The woman who had been bleeding for 12 years had been living behind barriers for that time. Shunned by society, not welcome in public spaces, refused entry into the synagogue, avoided by everyone. But when she saw Jesus, she saw her chance. The woman pushed through the barriers that life had built up around her, and through Jesus, received her freedom. Jesus is ready to help and to heal, and to go where he is most needed. But still, Jesus seems to have an infinite supply of patience that he could draw on. Okay, maybe one at a time. Sorry, maybe one time he seemed a bit short with someone, the woman at the well. But for the most part, he always showed patience. Of course, the point is to see not to see needs, people, opportunities as interruptions, but to see them as grace moments, to give and to receive, to be attentive and to be present, to be alive and be real, to be like Jesus. He always showed patience. So, be like Jesus. That's an easy one to say, isn't it? Be like Jesus. I'm sure we all try to be like Jesus, but it's not that easy, is it? But we can be in one way, we can be like Jesus. We can show grace to one another, grace to others. But there's more than just an interruption. There is healing. There is acceptance. There is life out of death. There is hope. There is life restored. Why does Jesus tell them not to tell when, let's be honest, they wouldn't be able to stop telling, would they? If your 12-year-old daughter's suddenly healed, you're not going to keep it quiet, are you? It's going to be hard to keep it quiet. When Jesus undoes a funeral, which is what they will have been preparing for, or actually even in the process of. Well, let's be honest. When Jesus interrupted the funeral, it was not what they expected. Perhaps he commanded them not to tell, but to say who got to do the telling. The only ones in the room with this little girl were her parents and the three disciples that Jesus brought along with him. Maybe Jesus was setting the precedence for witnessing. Maybe he was saying, tell your own story, not someone else's, and tell it with your living rather than with your words. And he said, first, give us something to eat. Now, Jairus is a leader of the synagogue, Mark tells us, and that gives him some status. He's a person that others go to. He's a decision maker. He has resources. He has position. He has power. He is used, I'm sure, to solving all his own problems. But he's got this problem. My little daughter. Now, we learn later in the passage that she was 12 years old, so almost an adult. She was of marriageable age, ready to move out and move on. Yet this leader of the synagogue refers to her as my little daughter. And he asked Jesus to lay his hands on her, to bless her, ordain her, set her apart, heal her, save her. The word that we translate here is sozo, and that's sometimes translated to heal, sometimes translated as to save, as in, are you saved? Save her, he asks, so that she may be made well and live. But he doesn't just ask, does he? He begs. He's on his knees, he's face down in the dust, clinging to Jesus' ankles, begging. And that's a follower. He hadn't been a follower before, as far as we can tell. But he is now, because he interrupted the interruptible Jesus, and he pleaded with him for help. I can't do this alone. I need help. I need Jesus' help. Now, we've already worked out that the track I played at the beginning, called Grace, was from U2. And those that know me well amongst you will know that I'm a huge U2 fan. So it's no surprise. But actually, when I was preparing for this talk, that was the song that came into my head. And I don't know if it's because I've been playing a lot of U2 in the car recently. Anyone who sees me drive past will probably be able to hear it. U2 needs to be played loud. But it's all about grace. It's all about the totally unmerited favor of God. Because we live in God's grace. He pours it out for everyone. Some respond, some don't. It is so often easy to think that God's grace is limited to those who go to church, for instance. Not at all. It's not, it's for everyone. But you do need to respond, of course. But it's not limited. There isn't a formula that you have to say, you know, a particular phrase that you have to say in order to claim it. It's there for the taking. You just need to look to God. Grace says it doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter that you've messed up. God made you, he created you, and he loves you more than you can imagine. Grace steps in and steps up and was demonstrated on the cross. Grace was shown by Jesus when he was interrupted. Grace was shown by Jesus to a distraught leader of the synagogue. Grace was shown to the 12-year-old girl that Jesus healed. Grace was shown to the woman who had suffered for 12 years with bleeding, being shunned by her own community. Grace, she takes the blame. She covers her shame, removes the stain, as our song tells us. You see, sin is a stain on our lives, but grace removes it. As C.S. Lewis pointed out, grace is a thought that changes the world and finds goodness in everything. Grace is there for everyone. It's God's gift to his creation, and it crosses all barriers. those erected by the church, and those who want to protect the bubble that they live in. But no, this gift of grace is God's gift to everyone and anyone. Yes, it is a gift that seeks a response, but it's still a gift which is totally unmerited, totally unexpected, and totally at the pleasure of God. Jesus never expected it to be a gift guarded by anyone and then kept safe. The lady who had suffered 12 years had been shunned by the very community which she was a recipient of, she'd been shunned by the very community that had been a recipient of God's grace from the very beginning. And yet, those who had placed themselves in authority had refused to let her have the hem of Jesus' robe. That tiny amount of grace. But as that woman stretched out her arm and tugged on his hem, the power left Jesus, filled her, and healed her. Grace makes beauty out of ugly things. Who are we to limit the blessings of God's grace? We should be throwing it out to everyone. We should be welcoming everyone, encouraging everyone. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for grace. We thank you that you have given it to us as a free gift, a gift that's not to be held on to, but to be shared. May we offer our communities that gift in the way we live life, in the way we seek to share your good news with our friends, our neighbours, and all whom we meet. Amen. So, what have you been getting up to in that pew there? Or perhaps we'd rather not know. So Holly, are you going to bring the things out?
Stand on the pew. We've done two get well cards. Our legs, yes.
Right, okay.
We're not going to show both.
She's still not going to show us.
And we've got a flower as well, haven't we?
Fantastic. And what did you learn in your pew?
What do we learn? Who learned to give themselves? We're going to give it to Auntie Jude because she had knee surgery on Wednesday.
Oh, right.
So we're going to give them to Auntie Jude to cheer her up and show us that kind.
Fantastic. Brilliant. Right. Well, we're going to just conclude the service, our worship now, and then we're going to have our final song, which speaks of this amazing God, how great thou art. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand has made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. We can have the band out.
That wants to compete with Bono and you too, but we'll get short. Thanks, Geoff.
It did probably take him a long time recording in the studio to do that.
We may not be able to sing as a congregation just yet, but as it says in the words of this wonderful song, our souls can sing, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you.
There is something great about live music, though. I can understand what people have been missing. So thank you to our band this morning. It's fantastic. I'm just going to conclude with a blessing, really. Just to say that next week, Oasis is in Copmanthorpe, back in Copmanthorpe. There's no need to book, as there isn't here. And just come along, join in. And we'll hopefully be live streaming again and sharing with a wider congregation. So if you can't make it, you can still join us on our usual YouTube channel and be a part of what we're doing. But I'd really encourage you to come along as we're returning to live worship, in the sense that we're in a building, and just being church again. It's great to be with people. I think that's what we've really missed. It's all very well looking at pictures on a screen, but it's not the same, is it, as being in the same building as people? So anyway, let's stand for a final blessing. May Almighty God surround us with his love, pour out upon us his grace, and lead us in his ways. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, remain with you, and all those whom you love, now and forevermore. Amen.